Welcome to Unity of Mesa Online. Your soul is welcome here. I'm Reverend Kathy Kellogg, and today I'm joined by John Groves, who's doing platform and leading meditation, Arn Richardson, our board member of the day, and our musician, Jennifer Sheets. Together, we welcome you, and we're so grateful that you've joined us today in our continuing exploration of Jesus' parables. Today, we're looking at the prodigal son in the title called Lost and Found. And our affirmation then today is, whatever I'm searching for, God is the answer. Will you say that with me? Whatever I am searching for, God is the answer. And I invite you now to join me in prayer by gently closing your eyes and breathing deeply into our body, focusing that breath on our heart space, letting that heart life expand and fill our minds and our bodies and our soul. We breathe and accept that life-giving peace of spirit as we remember all the places in our bodies that seek relief and healing. We breathe into them. We breathe into all those places in our mind to bring order, peace, and resolution, or at least to be comfortable with the questions we hold there. We breathe into that love light and let it embrace all the places in our outer world that seek healing. For those on our prayer list seeking healing of mind, body, and spirit. For those souls and their families in Denver and Atlanta. For those in positions with the power to make change compassionately and authentically. We breathe in the goodness of the divine, affirming the wholeness we are, and know that whatever we are searching for, God, unconditional love, infinite wisdom, universal spirit is the answer. And for that, we are grateful. And so it is. Amen. And now for our first song, Jennifer.
Sunshine, brand new day, I've got a train to catch, I'm on my way. Headlines on the paper say, there's no chance of rain today. Coffee in a paper cup, I'm downtown but I'm looking up, where the rooftops touch the sky and the birds are singing.
Today, I see the world through day. Here are a few things for you to know. On Wednesday at 7 p.m., Reverend Kathy will lead an online spiritual communion service designed to fill thought and feeling with a strong realization of the Christ presence. Tune in to this prayer service on Facebook or YouTube as preparation for conscious union with Spirit. Next Sunday is Easter, and we are offering two services and three different ways to watch. Our sunrise service is at 7 a.m. outside in the garden, and at 10:15 we'll have Easter service in the sanctuary. Both of these services will stream online to watch live or enjoy later. Please note, services will follow CDC guidelines with masks and distancing and no live music. Registration opens after today's service. We highly encourage you to sign up as we will have limited seating. This will also save time checking people in. We are very excited to welcome back Daniel Namod as our special pre-recorded musical guest, and you as well, of course. We look forward to seeing you then. Charles Fillmore said, "There will be more people in our churches when there is more laughter in them." And although we will not be in our church on April 11, we will be bringing you laughter with special guest Greg Tamblyn. Greg weaves together humor, music, stories, and sacred meditation to enlighten and inspire us with a healthy dose of music and laughter and a deep experience of the sacred. You will not want to miss this service. Spirit group registration is now open. We're excited this year to offer Transformed in Truth with the Reverend Michael Gott of Unity of Houston. We now have 6 groups to choose from, all online. Only 8 people per group, so don't delay in signing up. Groups begin the week of April 11. This Saturday, Reverend Judy and Gretchen Bickert are holding a special group workshop in the sanctuary, Healing Our Grief. This is for anyone who has lost a dear one, including a longtime pet, and is still struggling with grief. Find out more on these and several new classes coming in April on our Things for You to Know button at unityofmesa.org. You will also find information and access to our virtual fellowship, prayer support, registrations, and more.
Hello, I'm Aaron Richardson, member of your Board of Trustees. As you must know by now, both Reverend Judy and Reverend Kathy are retiring within the year. Judy is with us for another 6 months until September of 2021, and Kathy is with us until the end of January of 2022. Their contributions to our community have been immeasurable and will ensure that we step into the future successfully. They will be greatly missed. We join with them as we affirm the highest and best good during this ministerial transition. Currently, we are exploring who we are as Unity of Mesa and consider what values, needs, and qualities of life we wish to serve while we're having fun connecting with each other. Our next discussion group will be meeting today, Sunday, March 28th, from noon to 2 p.m. I attended the first one and greatly appreciate the wisdom expressed by our congregants and our very diverse viewpoints. This Zoom meeting is being facilitated by Gregory Riard, who is a Unity Worldwide Recommended Transition Consultant. And for your information, you can go to our website, unityofmesa.org, and click Things for You to Know. At Unity of Mesa, we are the change agents of the world through our prayers, affirmations, shining our light, and giving from our abundance. We as a spiritual community committed to self-discovery and spiritual growth support the work of the greater good as we enlighten, empower, and energize one another to uplift our world through a greater expression of God. There are very many ways for you to financially support this spiritual community. You can support us directly by sending a check, through online giving, or using the Give Plus app. You can donate a vehicle or share from your stimulus check. If you're watching on YouTube, just click in the link in the description below. All the information on how to give and more can be found on our website. Now, I invite you to take your gift of love in your hands and say with me our offering blessing. Divine love, flowing through me, blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Thank you, Spirit of Abundance. Now let's prepare ourselves for meditation, followed by a song.
Now let's prepare for our time of meditation. Our affirmation for today is, whatever I am searching for, God is the answer. Jesus, in his Sermon on the Mount, proclaimed in part, seek and you will find. And the prophet Jeremiah, after the fall of Jerusalem, wrote to the surviving exiles in Babylon, after they had lost their nation and many of their hopes, when you search for me, you will find me, referring to God. With these words to encourage and guide us, let's find a comfortable sitting position, close our eyes, and with our feet on the floor and our hands in our laps, breathe deeply in and out, in and out as we enter the silence. Now, let's take note of our surroundings and return to rejoin our service.
Thank you, Jennifer. Well, today is Palm Sunday. It's the day that is marked on the Christian calendar as the beginning of Holy Week, the week that led up to Easter and Jesus' resurrection. We know Palm Sunday as the day that Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey, and the people waved palm branches and laid them before him as he entered the city. So where did those people come from and how did they know him? He'd been teaching for, 3 years and did such amazing things and said such wonderful things that people followed him. And when you follow someone, you hear them teach, and some of his teachings were so profound that they've lasted through the centuries and come to us in the Gospels, still pertinent today as they were then, as they were meant to stir their interpretation, to upset, to provide confusion of what they thought the world was like, and to question and to find new ways of thinking. So we want to continue to explore the parables that he taught, the teachings that endeared people to him and why they followed him. And we're looking at the parables because those, I think, are the most profound. John Dominic Crossan, in the book, The Power of Parables, said the short definition of parables is stories that never happened, but always do, or at least should. Jim Gaithard's book, Hidden Realm of God, wrote that parables tend to be suggestive rather than directive. The intention is to provoke contemplation rather than to give rules for behavior, perhaps intended to open people up to seeing things in a new way, to go deeper. And we've talked about how parables were taught and that Jesus didn't interpret them for them, but left them open for his listeners to assign meaning to it wherever they were and whatever sense it made to them where they were in their own lives. But so people followed him, and it included everybody. It included farmers and fishermen and carpenters and people who lived in town and the people who lived in the country. It included tax collectors and sinners, which didn't make the Pharisees and the scribes very happy. The Pharisees was a sect of Judaism that was distinguished by strict observance of the traditional and written law. Dot your I's, cross your T's. And the scribes existed in the form of lawyers, basically. So here you've got these guys that adhere strictly to the written and traditional law, and you've got the lawyers, and they're not very happy with Jesus because he has tax collectors and sinners near him listening to his teachings. And I think Jesus must have had enough of it, because the writer of the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, has Jesus telling three parables right in a row about lost: the lost sheep, the lost coin, the lost son. Perhaps to inform the Pharisees and the scribes what he thought about everybody, that everybody had a place to listen and to learn. So his first parable was on lost sheep. And he said, which one of you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, lay it on his shoulder and rejoices. And when he comes home, calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost. Or that woman having 10 silver coins, if she loses one of them, who does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she has found it, calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I have lost. And then he entered into the third parable, which is probably the most famous one, probably along the Good Samaritan, which is the lost son or the prodigal son. Let's read that one for those who have forgotten pieces of it or have never heard it before. Then Jesus said, there was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of property that will belong to me. And so he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all that he had and traveled to a distant country. And there he squandered his property in desolate living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country, and the boy began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But then he came to himself and said, how many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare? And here I'm dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands. And so he sent off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around his son and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his slaves, Quick, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And get the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they begin to celebrate. Now his elder son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. And he replied, Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has got him back safe and sound. The brother became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him, but he answered his father, Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed your command. Yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But this son of yours comes back, this son who has devoured your property with prostitutes, and you kill the fatted calf for him. Then the father said to his eldest son, Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found. Jesus told the story to help provoke thought, and the meaning assigned most traditional, because Jesus didn't, but the Christian church and the early writers and followers of Jesus assigned this traditional meaning for the church, with the Father representing God and the unconditional love that the Father has for us. The younger son being those of us who've lived in the material world and are ready to return to the unconditional love of God, knowing that it doesn't matter what we've done or where we've been, God loves us and embraces us, wants us to come back, and it is ready to meet us the minute we turn around. Where the older son is those of us who get stuck in our religiosity and judgment of others, thinking that we've towed the line, that we've been lived moral lives, so the good stuff should be ours, right? Should be ours. So that is the traditional meaning that is assigned to it and that people could understand in the early church. But let's delve a little deeper and let's see what's looking and happening in this story by looking at the characters. When we look at the younger son, what do we know about him? We know that he rejected his father through the journey of self-discovery, right? Thought there was pleasure to be found, and it would mean that he didn't need his father. Just give me my inheritance, and I'm going to go live my own life. And he became occupied with the world of senses, wasted his resources, and in that forgot who he was, forgot about his father. The older son rejected his father through self-sufficiency, through morality. He thought he was so good he didn't need his father, right? He thought he deserved his blessing, that he actually was owed it. And in his envy, he forgot that all the father had was his. And because he got stuck in that envy, he couldn't participate in the celebration of abundance that his father put forth. So what character are we missing? We're missing the character of the father. And yet, what a character this is in the story. This man never stopped loving either son, even though both sons dishonored him. He expressed the unconditional love for both, but neither of them recognized it. He welcomed his wayward son with open arms, with no sense of guilt, no punishments. He didn't impose any conditions. He just showered him with blessings. The son even asked for the forgiveness, but the father doesn't acknowledge it. It's as if he's saying, stop worrying that you've lost my approval. You can't lose it. Just accept my unconditional love. And to the older son, it's like he's saying, stop trying to earn my approval. You can't earn it. Just accept my unconditional love. And if we want to go further, let's look at Who really is the prodigal in this story? Want to delve deeper? Let's look at the definition of what prodigal is. It's an adjective meaning spending money or resources freely and recklessly, wastefully extravagant. Wastefully extravagant. So when we look at the younger brother, who normally we consider to be the prodigal son, he did take his inheritance and squandered it, right? Wastefully extravagant with his inheritance until there was no more. But what about the older son? Could he not be the prodigal son? Because wasn't he wastefully extravagant about the good that he had but never availed himself of? He squandered by not availing himself of the good and of all that he already had, right? And what about the father? Could he be the prodigal? Because he was extravagantly wasteful with his love for both sons. No conditions, no guilt, no punishment. I just love you. You don't need to earn my approval. You don't need to worry that you've lost my approval. I love you no matter what. So who could be the prodigal son? The younger, the older, the father? Let's go down one more level and look at it metaphysically. And let's see that the son and the father are really one person. When we think of divine mind and being a divine idea in the divine mind, we realize that son and the father are really one person. The father representing the wholeness of us, the Christ in us, the divine. And the son representing that present level of consciousness, the present level of experience, that present level of what we know at this time in our human experience. And as the son, that human experience, that human consciousness comes to believe that the key to life and living is at the circumference. It's at that place of having things, of having prestige and power and money. But at the circumference is also where sickness, failure, unhappiness, and inner and outer turmoil exist. And then when we come to ourselves, when we see life experience for what it is and what we are, we wake up and return to the Father and return in consciousness to the whole person we really are. And in that returning are greatly blessed. We rise out of our limited consciousness and stop living at the edges, at the circumference of the material world. And we stop feeling sorry for ourselves and accept the truth about ourselves. What is that truth? Is that every person is innately divine. Anybody can come to themselves, right? Because the goal of everyone and every experience in life is an opportunity to take the step that leads to glorious possibilities. Julie Tregloan, who wrote the Foundations of Unity paper for my class, wrote that the human state of bondage serves the purpose of helping us realize our oneness with God. And when that happens, when we realize our oneness with God, there's no more perception of bondage. When we tire of eating the pig's leftovers as we did the prodigal son and remember to whom we belong, we are then ready to arise and claim our inheritance through Christ. We move from sickness, sorrow, and poverty to health, joy, and abundance. So moving from the physical to the spiritual, we find meaning in that affirmation that whatever I am searching for, God is the answer. The divine of ourselves is searching to reunite that human side of us into the oneness, so there's no separation, no duality. Ernest Holmes, a New Thought writer and teacher and the founder of religious science, now known as the Centers for Creative Living, wrote this. There is hidden within the mind of man a divinity. There is incarnated in you and me that which is an incarnation of God. This divine sonship is not a projection of that which is unlike our nature. It's not a projection of the divine into the human. God cannot project itself outside of itself. God can only express itself within itself. There is and can be no such thing as a distinct or separate individual that would be separate from the universe. Man, woman, is not an individual in God, for this would presuppose isolation, separation, and disunion. We are an individualization of God. There is no God beyond truth and no revelation higher than the realization of the divine within us. The prodigal son reminds us to come back, to leave that human experience, to rise out of that level of consciousness into a higher consciousness, into divine mind, to those divine ideas where abundance and well-being exist and dwell. But you know, the most interesting thing about this parable is that when the story ends, it's before we learn if the father's efforts at reconciliation have been successful. The father ends with the statement that really says that to his elder son, well, remembering your own blessing, can you also rejoice in the blessings of others? We're left to wonder if the younger brother sought to make amends, whether the older brother set aside his bitterness and joined the feast celebrating his brother's return, or did he keep himself apart, stuck in that all-consuming judgment and antipathy? I wonder, for the story doesn't end. The story continues. The story invites us. It provokes our contemplation to see what more we can learn from it. And so I ask you, where is the story living in you? Where is that younger son within you seeking separation to live in the circumference of life? Where is the older brother in you that gets stuck in self-righteousness and judgment? Where is that open arms of the higher consciousness, the wholeness of you seeking to embrace the pieces to bring it back into wholeness, into oneness? I hope that this parable provokes your seeing your life in a new way, and to know that whatever you are searching for, God is the answer. Blessings.
If I could look down on this path I walk from somewhere way up high, I could see the crooked road that I have come. I've walked a mile with sorrow, I've walked a mile with joy, and now I'm less afraid of either one. For every tear I've cried, there's a smile that I have earned. For every mile I walk, there's a lesson I learn. I'm not lost, I am exploring. Life is an adventure worth enjoying. Though I may not know where I'm going, I am not lost, I am exploring. Some people choose to live their lives in quiet avenues, while others find a place in the parade. Some like me are seekers, we take less traveled roads, believing we can find a better way. And though I get discouraged, I won't be turning back. I have joy as my compass and faith as my map. I'm not lost, I am exploring. Life is an adventure worth enjoying. Though I may not know where I'm going, I am not lost, I am exploring. Are headed for the same destination, so why not blaze a trail that's got imagination? I'm not lost, I am exploring. Life is an adventure worth enjoying. Though I may not know where I'm going, I am not lost.
you, Jennifer, for the beautiful music. And thank you, John and Arn, for joining in today and supporting us. And thanks to all of you who've tuned in. I hope that you will ponder that question where the story is alive within you and let it provoke some new understanding. And to remember that whatever you're searching for, God is the answer. As we affirm that the light of God surrounds us, the love of God enfolds us, the power of God protects us, and the presence of God watches over us, wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Blessings.